Recording from St. Louis, Missouri, welcome to the Slap Save Pinball Podcast with your hosts, Chris Haper and Jason Fowler.
Welcome to the Slap Save Pinball Podcast. This is episode number 12. Today's date is February 20th, 2019. I am Jason.
And I am guest host Matt Koenen.
So you might be wondering, Matt Koenen, where is Chris? Where is our resident crab ass? Well, he is not feeling real well. He's a little ill, and I brought it up with Matt, and he asked me, I thought it was pretty funny, he asked if it was an investigation by the SEC over all of his unreported earnings from his pinball investments.
Yeah, I'm still not convinced that it isn't.
He's under full investigation, but we may sound a little different this time because Matt and I are actually under the same roof. Usually, Chris and I are doing this on separate residences, and I think Chris does it in his underwear. And
so am I.
Yeah. No, we're not. So I've known Matt. I guess we met sometime last year, right?
Yeah, middle of last year.
Where did we meet at? You want to explain Swain?
Okay, so I have a buddy named Swain, and he's actually the one that got me into the hobby. This was back before he had 28 machines of his own. He only had about 10, and I got the bug from him. So I purchased my first machine about 5 or 6 years ago.
I guess I met Mike Swain. Super nice guy. They'll do anything for you. He's really easy to get along with.
Yeah,
he
definitely.
Actually, I contacted him through Pinside, and we talked about potentially getting together at some point and talking pinball and just checking out each other's machines. That sounds kind of dirty, but it's not.
And that's like catnip to somebody.
Yeah, it is. So he ends up having like a shindig at his house and invites me over and actually was like, oh, it's kid friendly if you want to bring your son. And, you know, that was all I needed to hear. So we went over, and him and Koenen were already friends. So that was where we all sort of kind of met. And we always laugh now because he has these like internet stranger parties.
Yeah.
And I was part of one of the internet stranger parties that worked out. But we always laugh and think it's just a matter of time before an axe murderer shows up.
And well, you might be still.
I'm a very calculated axe murderer. Yeah. I haven't sunk my axe into anyone yet.
Patrick Bateman style. But yeah, Swain's girlfriend, whenever she's busy in any given night, that's when he takes the chance to have internet stranger parties.
Mandy's great.
Yeah. Mandy does not approve of the internet stranger parties, but it worked out this time.
This time,
With Jason, we all met and fell in love.
So yeah, Chris is a little under the weather. He's not feeling real well, and it started getting late enough in the week where I reached out to Matt and asked him if he wanted to participate in this, and he did, and here we are.
I agreed, and only then found out that I don't get paid for it.
Yeah, the pay is really, really
shitty. Yeah.
And with the fame and the girls, it offsets it. Not really. Yeah. Not really. Not at all. No. So, as far as like pinball goes and what you have at your house, like what are some of your favorite games, or what do you own?
My favorite game that I own is Simpsons Pinball Party.
I know this.
I tell everyone that I'm going to be buried in that machine. People have asked me to purchase it. People have made offers on it. People love it. I love it more. It will never, ever, ever leave my house.
Now, you and Swain actually traded games for a while, right?
Yeah, I traded him my Simpsons for his Lord of the Rings. And then I couldn't get my Simpsons back for the longest time.
Uh-huh.
Swain's the one that holds the keys to his van that moves our pinball machines around. So he held all the power and it took me forever to get my Simpsons back. But we finally made the switch again last month.
Like, what are you in the middle of right now? Are you doing anything as far as pinball goes? Well, I think you might have a project on your hands.
Yeah, I have a big project on my hands. My first game, Elvira and the Party Monsters, they finally released... CPR finally released the reproduction playfield. So I
that was the first game you owned.
That was the first game I owned.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, I've had that since February of 2013.
Okay, wow, some sentimental value there.
Yeah,
all right.
Yeah, and it's not a overly complex game, but it's a lot of fun.
Oh, I think it's fun.
But I'm in the middle of a playfield swap for it, and I started back in November. Got about halfway through it. I got the easy part done, which is taking everything off. And then it kind of got put on the back burner because of work, and I had been going back to school. Then I found out that my wife bought me a shuffleboard table. But now that means I have to get this play field all put back together, because currently Elvira is taking up my entire pinball room.
I haven't done that, but I can imagine that takes up quite a bit of room.
Yeah, it takes up quite a bit of room.
Uh-huh. I can see that. I can see that.
But it's fun. That's half the fun for me.
Well, welcome to the podcast.
Well, thank you very much for having me.
Thanks for joining us. I don't know how I would have done this by myself. It would have gotten really ugly really quickly.
It probably would have gone a lot smoother,
though. I don't know. I can't talk to myself very well. So
that's not what Cindy tells me.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Well, on my end, I guess I don't know if any of you, if I've talked about it or not, but I paid for in full and ordered a Monster Bash remake back in November through Planetary Pinball. And my method of thinking was that, you know, since they own the license, they would probably get a little better allocation than a lot of other providers or a lot of other companies. So it did work out. I did get one of the first non-number matching ones, but little did I know it was going to take months to do so. I guess they had some issues with playfields not meeting their expectations. And it finally came. I think about a week ago, I got a notice that it was being shipped, and it showed up. And it's been relatively problem-free. The game looks great. The topper looks great.
Oh, it's beautiful.
It is a good-looking game. And it's funny because Koenen was over at the house the other night, and I was telling him and I've since gotten on Pinside and noticed that there's some other people saying the same thing, that there's some issues with the right orbit feeding the actual flipper. So it actually either gets into Dracula's feet when he's nested in the coffin, or it will hit the slingshot top and obviously, you know, it throws everything into chaos. So we were trying to make sure that the machine was dead nuts level, and I think it pretty much is.
Yeah,
and
we spent 20 minutes leveling
it. We did. We really got it dialed in as far as the leveling goes. And I think it's just going to have to come down to one of a couple things. And one of the guys online was saying that you can actually move Dracula on his bracket to where it gets sucked into that coffin a little better. And then that removes him from the equation. And then you have to adjust that like actual feed of itself, of the orbit, you know, with a screwdriver or whatever, and just bend it out a little bit. Yeah. So I think it's doable. I did watch Papa's got a tutorial video. It shows it doing it.
Yeah. And then it does the exact same thing where it comes out of that right orbit and brushes the side of the slingshot enough that it activates the slingshot and kicks it out.
And then Matt also brought up, he said, well, I was also looking at Jack Danger's dead flip stream when he blew it up. He did like 1.6 billion on it or something that I can't even fathom. His was actually going right to the flipper. Yeah. But I watched the entire video, and I meant to tell you, if you notice, there's times where it actually feeds the left flipper to where it's brushing something. I don't know if it's Drac or whatever, but It's actually set up to where it's too far left. So there's got to be a happy medium in there. I don't mean to bore you guys. I know you probably don't give two shits about the details of Monster Bash, but that is what I've been up to and what I've been doing. We are also in the process of getting some t-shirts. We wanted to have something that would, I guess, kind of help spread the word of the podcast when we're in Texas. I think Chris might be going. I know I'm going for sure. I'm dragging my wife down there, and we are going to, we're going to make it a pinball weekend. I'm sure she's really looking forward to it. But I have gotten the standard logo t-shirts that are coming. And then I also contacted Tim Lee, who, if you recall, with Double Danger, they do t-shirts for pinball t-shirts. He did the Tilt Monster graphic. It's actually like a monster that is chewing on a pinball machine. I actually commissioned him to do a unique logo for our podcast. So as soon as that gets done and gets sent my way, I will share that with you guys on like the Facebook page or Bat Signal or whatever. But you will see it at some point. So went to Padavan's, which is a local bar here in St. Louis that has a lot of pinball machines. I played the hell out of some Munsters.
Really?
Played what the did you hell think? Out of it. So it's a pro. It was a pro, right?
All
right.
So color.
Yes, it was color. So, all right. Chris has an LE coming. So I have to like tread carefully here. And I also respect the hell out of everybody at Stern. So I don't want to piss anybody off. But here are my thoughts on Munsters. If you love the Munsters theme, this is a must buy. If you are maybe not so enamored with the theme, I would drop some coin in it and let it be.
Okay.
I think. So the pro. Now, again, this is the pro. I haven't played the lower playfield version or the spike popping out of the stairs or anything like that. The shots are very derivative. It's just, it feels like most other Sterns. And I'm starting to feel that way a lot about what is coming down the pipe there. I know the talent that sits in those halls at Stern. And the only thing that is keeping them from innovating and creating like they're capable of is the purse strings are just being held just slightly too tight.
Okay.
That's my feelings on it. I may be completely off base. I may be completely wrong this, but I know what Borg is capable of making. And the, don't get me wrong, there's some cool stuff in it. The ramps are very unique. The right ramp, how it like, it kind of does this like, it goes upside down and feeds a ramp on top, almost like big guns, how it had those.
Oh, yeah,
like,
those cannons.
Yeah, like the ball actually like comes out of the habit trail and into a flared habit trail. So it's just something different, you know, and it's like, yeah, you did something different, but do that on a much grander scale. Like just do more different things. You know, the animations are phenomenal. Like they had a ton of assets and you can tell they used every damn second of assets they had. In fact, some of them run a little long in my opinion, but that can be.
Does it kind
of
bog
a little bit?
Okay.
A little bit, but that can be cleaned up with code and, you know, easily down the road. But it's a fun game. My wife loved it. Which she doesn't love a lot of pinball games. She actually loves Monster Bash too. So I guess she has this thing for horrors.
Yeah. Well, she also loves you.
So yeah, that is true.
Her judgment might not be.
Yeah. The best. Yeah. She's used to scary things. So, yeah, but she loved it. And, I think it's a great game. It's worth a buy, especially if that is in your wheelhouse as so far as game goes.
So what you're saying is you think it might be kind of the opposite of those threads you see out there where what game is better than the source material, where you might not like, no one really likes the movie Congo, but the pinball machine itself is fun, so they play it.
That's a great way to put it. I think Iron Maiden fell into that.
Okay.
I own Iron Maiden, right? No one will ever accuse me of being a Iron Maiden honk as far as their music goes. It's not like I grew up wearing Iron Maiden t-shirts. What I feel though, Iron Maiden represents a unique pinball machine that offers enough different shots that to me it was compelling enough to make me want to go out and buy it. Where I feel like Munsters is maybe just kind of a mirror image of that, where if you love that theme and you really want that theme in your house or you have some draw to that growing up, that's fine. But don't expect something different. It's a standard like fan layout. It's got a few little different things. It's got that kind of that catapult like shot on the left side. But it's got a bash toy that's, you know, it's kind of run of the mill.
Mm-hmm.
It's got the standard fan layout with the ramps, and I just don't feel like it's something that is going to turn the world upside down as far as pinball goes.
No. Does it have the typical stern top right trio of bumpers?
It does. Yeah, like the pops. Yeah, they're kind of in the same spot. Yeah, that's the thing. It's just, I know there's only so much space that you can do different things with in pinball, but damn it, try. Do something.
There are so many games out there that are utterly unique with the same amount of space.
And if you think about like all the games in history, we're going to talk about Indiana Jones here in a little bit. The Indiana Jones, the Twilight Zones, the Addams Families, even like games that are more run-of-the-mill, like Getaway 2, you know, High Speed, they all offer a different shot layout. And I feel like we're getting, if you look at the top down of Metallica, Guardians of the Galaxy, Munsters,
Star Wars,
and everything, and you squint, and you made it black and white to where you couldn't see the color differences.
We're getting the pro.
Yeah.
Oh, no, premium.
That would work too. But I'm just saying, if you couldn't see the colors to allow you to differentiate the game, I really think people would have a hard time telling what it was.
Yeah.
I'd love to see a little more daring, a little more, you know, stick our neck out a little bit.
And that's not to say that these games aren't fun.
No, I love it. I had a blast playing Munsters, and I'm really looking forward to playing the premium. I think this might be one of those games where I think a premium or an LE might be worth paying extra for just because of the extra stuff involved. So.
Plus, the premium gets you that color by numbers. You get some Sharpies and color it in yourself.
My son would probably be all over that. That's funny. Franchi, he worked hard making that black and white play field, but I think you either love that or it's not really your thing. And myself, I love his color and I love the brightness of pinball. So I would probably lean more towards the LE or the Pro. Yeah. So.
And now, Slap Save Pinball's 60-second news.
Penberg tickets will go on sale this Saturday, February 23rd at noon Eastern Standard Time. Make sure you're ready because they don't last long. There should be 1,000 of them. Pinball Adventures, the company behind the Todd Tuckey book deal that went south, has announced that they intend to release a pinball machine. Speaking of Todd Tuckey, he was featured on PBS's Counterculture, episode number 2, where he states that he has sold over 26,000 machines and gives a great quick interview about the hobby. Scott DeNisi posted a photo on Facebook showing his quote-unquote next game. If you are gullible or susceptible to trolling, it will be Haunted House Party. But I don't think anyone believes that. Texas Pinball Festival posted their schedule. It is getting close. Check it out. It's on their website. So, are you a tournament player, Matt? You should be.
I've played in a couple tournaments over at the Silver Ballroom. And I have a lot of fun doing it. It's just I never think to look it up and actually go anymore.
So I know, like, I am okay at pinball, right? I'm okay. I'm not awesome. I'm not horrible. I can beat my wife pretty regularly. I have the occasional game where I can beat guys that I consider to be better players, but the two better players that I know are probably Chris and Matt. They're both good players, and a lot of times I will go to Koenen here and I will say, what am I supposed to be shooting for? What's a good strategy here? Because I feel like I am just flailing at blinking lights, but I'm okay with admitting that. I've gotten better. As I've learned to control the ball a little better, things have went better.
And I'm actually kind of honored that you put me in the same group as Chris, because I've watched him play, and good Lord, he annihilated your Hobbit, didn't he?
He did. He absolutely destroyed it, and he's really proud of that.
Yeah.
And he's probably going to be happy that I brought it up on the show. Yeah, so I've had that son of a for probably, I don't know, at that point, probably a month and a half, and I've put probably, I don't know, 70 games on it. He walks up, and the first game,
how do I play this?
Yeah, he's asking me how to play it as he's, like, destroying my GC on it, which, Chris is very accurate Like, right? He is good at hitting particular targets that he wants to. And honestly, it's funny because I think Hobbit is one of those games where I call it a sniper game.
Oh, yeah.
It is like you have got to hit long distance shots very accurately.
It's like the old, what was that old EM? El Dorado.
Yep. Yep. Yeah, a lot of the old EMs where it really put more accuracy on anything else.
And that makes, I mean, there's a lot of stuff to do on The Hobbit, but that really makes it fun.
Yeah. Yeah. It's not a flail-friendly game.
No.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree. So the, did you happen to see that counterculture episode?
I didn't.
It's really cool. It's really brief. And it's made more toward, it takes place into a diner and it's this guy. I have no idea who it is, but it's worth a watch. It actually kind of paints pinball in a good light and it presents it to people that probably wouldn't know to think to ask about it otherwise. But it's an interesting, little quick episode that you can watch. I like Todd a lot and I think he's a great ambassador for the hobby and, yeah. Scott is trolling everybody with his it was funny because Matt asked me, he's like, tell me more about this, like what's going on.
Yeah, so I was clueless. What do you have in your notes here? Gullible or susceptible to trolling?
Yes,
that
so,
was me.
Well, right, well, so Scott is, he's an everyman who happens to be designing pinball machines.
Okay.
And that's what I love about Scott. Like he is just like you and I, if we all of a sudden found ourselves, we have created a great pinball machine. And he has taken all these things that happen in this hobby where people like are just living on the edge, constantly trying to guess what you're doing next and putting words in your mouth and everything. And he's ran with it to where they actually took a game and wrapped it and put a fake name on the side of it. And he's trolling.
What if it's a double bluff?
There is no way he is making a haunted house party. There is no way.
I mean, the concept of ghosts and ghouls and monsters having fun together and having like normal lives and they get together and having a party, that's never been done in a pinball machine before.
You know,
it's never been done in Elvira and the Party Monsters.
I would like to think
it's never been done in Monster Bash.
I would like to think it's more of like a kid and play thing.
Oh.
With the crazy hair.
Okay, haunted
house party. Haunted, but it's kid and play with their crazy hair.
No.
And their super white tennis shoes and their super sick dance moves.
Jesus.
So that, you know, a guy can hope. I doubt that they would be able to land that license.
Could he even afford that license?
I don't know. I can't remember the songs they had. I know that I probably danced to them at a stoplight somewhere in my prepubescent years.
Up in North County?
No, I grew up down here. I was not in NoCo. Yeah. But, yeah, it'll be interesting to see what happens with that. I don't think that he's doing a haunted house party. So, are you going to Texas?
I am not.
Damn it! You've got to go. People, I'm telling you, go to Texas.
I want to go.
Texas is the show to go to. I'm telling you, it's going to be a blast. Zach's going. Greg's going. Greg is actually leaving the house from straight down the middle, and he's going to Texas. That's the last I heard.
Oh, my God.
I know. It's a miracle. And Ken and Bill, good friends up at Special One Lit, they're going to be down there, too. I think they're flying high rollers.
Ooh.
Yeah, we're taking a caravan down there.
Are they taking business class?
I don't know. Ooh. I doubt it. Those guys are high rolling, man.
Brick Shot, the segment where the guys rant about some of the worst misses in pinball.
Next up, Chris usually does our Brick Shot, right? He usually goes on a tangent about something that is questionable. I'm going to do my version of Brick Shot, right? And what I'm talking about this week is the efforts lately to kind of undermine or discredit the Twippies. And Jeff Patterson, the guy behind This Week in Pinball that works so hard to put these sort of things together. It really disappoints me lately what I've been seeing with people saying that the process is not legitimate on how those votes are won. And I think what we're kind of seeing here is it's sour grapes.
Yeah.
On the very simplest of terms, it is people that maybe you have this gut instinct or gut feeling that they're not in the running, and their defensive mechanism is to lash out and question the legitimacy of
it. Yeah, and there was some talk about votes getting purchased, perhaps. This rubs me the wrong way. And if something can be exploited, it might be. But it's the pinball community. What do people have to gain by winning
exactly
the TWIPY?
Exactly. So at the end of the day, other than like literally waving that you won the TWIPY, which I don't know that's much to wave a about. What
I've
are you
it for less?
That's true. I've attempted helicopters for much less. But what I'm saying is, like, what do you have to gain, honestly, by winning a TWIPY?
Yeah, and it's
at its very simplest of terms, it is a way for us, and when I say us, everyone within the hobby, to celebrate the hobby.
Yeah.
It's to celebrate people that we feel are doing a good job of providing content and information. And you don't have to like the person that wins to still have respect for the process and still just allow them to bask in their 5 seconds of fame, even if it's that.
This isn't the Academy Awards.
No, not at all.
This isn't the Grammys, for better or worse.
Right.
This is the pinball community coming together and saying, I like this. I like that.
Yep.
It's all of us contributing, saying, well, I might not have played Munsters or Thunderbirds, but I definitely played Pirates of the Caribbean,
right,
and I liked it, so that's what I'm voting for.
Yep, I agree. We are new, right? We're a new podcast.
Yeah.
I hope someday down the road that we get a single solitary vote. I would be happy with that, because that means to me somebody out there appreciates the fact that we're taking the time to put this together for you guys, right? Whether the person that's winning, whether it's something you like or not, right? So whether it's a podcast that you, it's somebody that rubs you the wrong way or whatever, just shelve your opinions and just let them have it, and let Jeff enjoy the fruits of his labor as far as the whole process and making the TWIPYs what they can be. And just move along.
Yeah.
Just move along.
And they had, he had people like auditing the votes, didn't he?
Yes. He made an attempt and had a committee to try to prevent this from happening. But you don't have to taint the entire process and the entire show and the entire awards just because you don't like the results and you think that, or you're skeptical of the legitimacy of one particular vote.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah,
I it's bull.
Yeah, well,
if Chris was here, I think he would probably be saying the same thing
with a lot more
expletives. It's pinball, people. It's pinball.
We're supposed to be having fun here.
Yes, it's a fucking hobby. I just don't understand. It's a fucking hobby.
There's Chris.
Back off. Just fucking back off. God. All right. Next.
Flip it. Bolt it. Or torch it.
Flip, bolt, or torch. 1993 edition. We, you know, Kane and I sat here and we were like, what would be a good year that would really kind of, you know, get a lot of good titles in the mix?
There wouldn't be any easy targets.
No slam dunks for any of them. Yeah.
And so we went smack in the middle of the WPC golden era.
Yeah. You want to read them?
Yeah. So up for our Flip, Bolt, or Torch eligible titles of 1993, we have Gladiators by Gottlieb, Tales from the Crypt by Data East, Star Trek The Next Generation by Williams, Pistol Poker by Alvin G.
Poker in the rear.
Is there liquor in the front?
Yes.
The poker in the rear? All right. We've got Wipeout by Gottlieb, Judge Dredd by Bally, Indiana Jones The Pinball Adventure by Williams, Last Action Hero by Data East, Jurassic Park by Data East, Twilight Zone by Bally, Teed Off by Gottlieb.
That's a good one.
Bram Stoker's Dracula by Williams, Street Fighter II by Gottlieb, The Adventures of Rocky and Bullwinkle and Friends by Data East, and Whitewater by Williams.
That's a pretty damn good list,
that
right?
That is a solid list.
Yep, yep. So for those of you that weren't with us last week when we did this for the first time, what we have is Flip, Bolt, or Torch. Flip meaning, what game would you like to have as, I guess, the best potential for making a buck? Bolt would be the one that you feel like you are going to bolt to your basement floor or floor in your house, and you will keep till you are buried in it. It's just a favorite.
Mm-hmm.
And Torch would be something you would choose to use for firewood or possibly use for flamethrower practice. So it's a game that you obviously don't care much about. So let's start with Flip. We'll both do our flips. Which game do you think would be the one to flip for you?
Now, for me, I'm going to go with this title because I've actually done this. I've actually flipped this game.
Uh-huh.
I'm going with Indiana Jones for Flip. I really enjoyed playing it. I like the theme, but for how much money I could get for it, how much money I had sitting there in this pinball machine, I thought, you know what? I'm just going to move on.
Right.
I'm going to move on.
Right.
I got what I wanted out of it. I got some good fun. I got a good story about how I got it involving some cash in a tent.
Oh, you
got
to tell that. You got to tell that story.
Okay. Oh, Jesus.
Yeah. Just give the quick version.
Okay.
But yeah. You got
to
tell it.
Quick version. I was going to buy Indiana Jones from Cleveland.
The guy on Family Guy?
No. No. Cleveland, the city.
Oh,
Cleveland,
Ohio.
The city.
Oh,
yeah, okay. Cleveland, Ohio.
It was much better when it was Cleveland.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Swain and I and a couple of other of our friends were up in Ann Arbor for the VFW showcase.
Uh-huh.
And we were camping out in their parking lot there. And
intense, right?
Intense. And so we were waking up on Saturday morning and driving from Michigan to Cleveland to pick up Indiana Jones. And we get about, it's probably about a 2.5 hour, 3 hour drive from there.
Okay.
And we get about, I don't know, 20 miles outside of Cleveland. Swain's driving, someone else is sleeping up front, someone else is sleeping in the back, and I'm kind of dozing off in the back. And all of a sudden, I sit bolt upright and go, oh, f***. And everyone immediately knew. I left my $5,200 in my tent.
Cash money.
In my tent. In the VFW Vintage Flipper World parking lot.
Little hint. If you are ever at a show or like a camping pinball thing and you see Koenen show up, keep an eye on his tent.
Yeah, bright orange tent.
Yeah.
Go through it. You're bound to find my life savings. and all of us have Bank of America, and there isn't a Bank of America within 100 miles of Cleveland.
Right, right.
And so we were going from ATM to ATM getting our...
Digging up change, basically. Trying to buy a $6,000
Trying to get enough money for this pinball machine. We show up to this guy's house about 2 hours late with $5,100 and like 37 cents. in like 10s and 20s.
Right.
And he had a good chuckle about it. But
you ended up getting it. And here's the kicker. You got back to the tent, and what happened?
The money was there.
The money was still there.
The money was still there in my backpack in a tent in the middle of Michigan. And that's why I'm alive today, because my wife
did not murder me.
long story short, I got a good story and some good play out of Indiana Jones, and then I flipped it.
All right. So my flip would probably be, I would do Twilight Zone. And here's why. I think I am one of the people that is immune to the draw of Twilight Zone. I have never been a huge fan of the game. And I think a lot of it goes back to when I was in high school and playing a lot of arcade games back then. It was at every single arcade. every single one, and I just got burnt out on it, and I never really saw the draw of it.
Is it the modes? Do you know? It's a lot of finishing modes.
Yeah, I don't know what it is. It just never got its claws in me for some reason, and maybe that's a good thing because it's not a cheap game.
No, it's not,
and it's highly sought after, and it's one of the best selling machines ever.
Yeah, I think it's the best wide body.
That's probably a safe bet. That's probably a safe bet. And maybe I just haven't given it a fair shake. That's very well maybe. I've never owned it, but I know its value. And if I had one of these to get money out of, it would probably be that one or Indy, one of the two.
Yeah, I mean, it's a beautiful game.
Yeah, it is. Zone.
And it's fun to play, but it's not one that I would ever drop that amount of scratch on.
Yeah, it's not cheap. What about Bolt? Which one would you bolt to your floor? I think I know which one you're going to say.
So I think I would bolt Star Trek The Next Generation. I own that in the past, and I really regret trading it for a Game of Thrones premium.
I know you like Star Trek.
I love the theme. And I love that game.
Yep. I've owned it. I thought it was a great game. And I probably sold it a little too quickly. It's a little troublesome to keep running.
Oh, yeah.
It's got a lot going on. It's one of those super pens. And yeah. It's got a lot of complicated mechanisms and everything that are flying around. And
I never thought I'd find another game heavier than it until I found Hobbit.
It feels like there's Jimmy Hoffa is somewhere in the cabinet of that thing.
I stripped that entire playfield when I had mine to clean it. And it took forever.
Yeah. Yeah, it's got a lot going on.
It has a lot going on. But for me, that's half the fun. The problems that you have to fix, that's half the fun for me. So that's another reason why I love that game, because it was hard to keep running.
As long as you can get it running.
That's true.
You know, sometimes you can't.
Yeah, if you're banging your head against the wall, it ceases to be fun.
I was telling Matt, mine would probably be Indiana Jones, and that's just simply because I have owned Star Trek. So I just, for me, as much as I love the next gen, I just want to try something different. So I wouldn't bolt that to my floor because I've already had it once and it didn't bolt then. So I love the Indiana Jones trilogy, or the movies rather, and I that would be the one.
We're sticking with trilogy.
That
fourth one didn't happen.
Yeah, that wasn't good. I distinctly remember I telling my son how much I loved Indiana Jones, and I bought the set on Amazon, and we played the first one, and I think he was probably 10 at the time. It was like earlier this year, and the part comes up where the arc opens and the Nazis like faces like explode and stuff. He like still to this day is mad at me because he says that I scarred him by showing him that.
That's like a rite of passage.
It is. Yeah. I'm like, I was scarred with it. Yeah. You know, I'm like, hey, at least
I watched that Nazi's face melt in the womb.
I did. I watched it in slow motion. I was so enamored with it. And I said, hey, it could have been RoboCop losing a hand. That's what scarred me. I watched that at a friend's house when I was a kid. You sure it wasn't
RoboCop shooting that guy in the dick?
That I thought was funny. But when the guy got hit that had been dipped in the toxic waste, and then he just basically exploded on the windshield, that bothered me a little bit too. But yeah, Indy was old news by then. So, all right. Well, I guess next, finally, we have Torch. What are we going to torch out of this? This is a unanimous decision.
Now, there weren't a lot of contenders on this list for me as for torching.
There's not. A lot of times you kind of gravitate towards the Gottlieb games, but honestly, Gladiators is not a bad game.
Gladiators isn't bad.
Wipeout is not bad. I know you said you hadn't played it.
I hadn't played it.
It's not a world beater, but it's not. It's not worthy of flamethrower.
Out of all the Gottliebs, it's one of them.
Yes. Okay. Yes. Yes.
Street Fighter 2 isn't.
I've never played that.
It's bad.
Is it bad?
It's bad. But what?
You're wicked.
What really grinds my gears on a pinball game is if the callouts are irritating as hell, and so I would torch the hell out of Teed Off.
I would too.
I would.
That game is so awful. That big old plastic dome on top, it's just ugly.
If if I ever hear it yell from across a goddamn arcade, hole in one again, I'm going to.
I feel like it was a blatant ripoff of Caddyshack and its popularity at the time.
Oh, yeah.
And
did it come out the same time as No Good Gophers?
I think so. Yeah, they were both like, oh, you know, unlicensed gopher theme.
Something
golf.
That is similar to yet legally distinct from Caddyshack.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. And I played golf, and to me, it's just golf and pinball don't mix. That's just me.
Both got balls.
Yeah, they do. They do. Yeah, that's true.
But yeah, teed off. I would torch it in a heartbeat.
Matt, I want to thank you for coming, and you're going to have to come and join us again.
Yeah, I really enjoyed it. Thanks for having me. I'm sorry that Chris had to get picked up by the feds for me to get here.
Yeah, no problem. I think if Chris either ever does get picked up by the feds, or if he has an actual aneurysm to where he is no longer able to do the show, I think you would be a great stand-in to just swoop in.
Well,
you'll have to get much angrier, though.
Okay. Well, next time we won't do it at noon on a Wednesday.
That's right.
If we do it maybe even like 2 on a Wednesday, I can get good and drunk, and you'll get all the expletives out of me that you could ever want.
Well, I'll tell you a little secret. A couple of the better shows that we've had, we have done faced. So, well, in closing, we'd like to encourage your feedback, suggestions, comments, and do us a favor, go on one of the major podcasting websites and leave us a review. The best way to reach us is always email at slapsafepinballpodcast@gmail.com. You can always reach us on our voicemail comment line, 314-529-1875. We're on Facebook, of course. We're on Pinside. We're on Instagram. You can search for us on there. We're on Twitter. You can also see Chris when he has the time and is not deathly ill. He usually streams on Twitch at slap_save_. Thanks for joining us, and stay tuned for the next episode. We should be here about the same time, about the same place next week. We will catch you next time.
All right. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, no problem. See ya.